Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. When I say we, today we have Mr. Frank Washington, AboutThatCar.com, hanging out in Detroit, Chris Lawrence, our PhD, AutoAcademics.com, sitting in the, look like he has a tiger face there with the with the sunlight coming in hot Atlanta. So it must be pretty nice down there, getting you tanned.
Well, let's just say it's warmer than it was.
Oh, okay.
We'll yeah. take this high 40s.
Yeah, it was a little chilly here today, but I decided to sit outside anyway and do the show there from the outside. You see, Frank's all bundled up with his little
ski. He's got his hat on.
Everything.
They can say what they want. I'm no fool.
Now, Frank, you live long enough to know to stay warm, right?
This is true.
Okay, as always, folks, you can find us on blackpressusa.com. You can find us on Facebook. Give us a little love. You can find us on each one of the panelists' websites. If you check out below the video, they should have a link there to, or at least the name of their web pages. And at the end of the show, normally in the description, I have a link to each one of the panelists' websites. So please go check them out. Like I say, we all cover the industry, but we do it a little differently. We have a different flavor. It's not all the same. If you know an African-American male that's 30 plus, please make sure that he gets his PSA test done. It's just a little prick. Check some blood, check your PSA level. And if it's down there around 1-2, somewhere in that area, you okay. If it's a little higher, your doctor may want to say, let's just watch it and see what happens. It is a leading cause of death among African-American males, and there's not enough attention given to it. So if you've been watching the show for any length of time, I've started mentioning it on a regular basis because I think it is very, very important. Okay, we're going to talk about what are we driving this week. But before we get into that, some recalls to bring up here. Ford is recalling about 500,000 Super Duty Super Crew pickups, 2017-2019 model year. The seat belt pretensioners could cause a fire by sparking the interior carpet when in a crash. That's not a good thing, because if you're in a crash, it's bad enough that you're in the crash, but the second thing is you don't want to be looking for fire. I'm trying to get away from a fire. But 500,000, that's a pretty good size number. And GM wanted to hang out up there with them. GM has about 950,000. It's broken into two groups. First group is 550,000 of the 2019 Silverado 1500s, along with the Cadillac CT6 and the GMC Sierra 1500. Having some software issues. The service brake system may not work properly, the software, the electronic stability control, or anti-lock brake systems could be disabled. So the other 400,000 are recalls of the 2019 through 2020 Silverado 1500 and the GMC Sierra 1500. The battery positive cable rings have an excessive amount of glue on them that was done during the production, and they could possibly cause a fire there. Again, you don't want to have your vehicle on fire. And as always, please go, you can go to NHTSA.gov, enter your VIN number. That's a vehicle identification number. For those of you who may not know what VIN is, it's a 17 digit number that you can find in what left side of the windshield and on the door frame in a couple of places. But enter that number to see whether your car or your vehicle is under recall. If it is, call the dealer, make an appointment, be nice, take it in, get those recalls taken care of. Now, Mercedes-Benz had some recalls that they didn't take care of or notify owners in a timely manner. So NHTSA slapped them with a $13 million fine, even though they ended up notifying the owners that some of their cars were under recall. They didn't do it in a timely manner, according to NHTSA. I guess NHTSA must have asked them several times and they decided to not respond immediately. So they hit with a $13 million fine. And if they don't respond quickly to the next recall, it's going to cost them another $7 million. So NHTSA takes these recalls seriously. They've been still trying to clear up, as we all know, the Takata airbag situation. They actually went on the road, had a road show for that one. So recalls are very important. Can cost you or your family members your life, as well as other people that you're driving next to or around. So please, 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 please take care of those recalls. All right, guys, where are you driving this week? Frank, what are you in, or what do you have last week, or do you have anything?
Well, in answer to those five questions.
Okay. Are you going to take them in order, or you going to skip around?
Basically, what I'm going to do is get to the heart of the matter.
Okay.
And then I just swapped out a car or vehicles today. And so that's saying that I just got out of it's a throwback of sorts. I just got out of a Lexus GX 460. And when I say throwback, it's not as big as an LX, but it's a three-row sport utility, body-on-frame construction. It's one of these vehicles that gas mileage is non-existent. You know, it's like a 300 horsepower V8. I think the mileage is because I'm literally writing it up as we speak, and the mileage on this thing was it's 15 miles a gallon in the city. And 18 miles a gallon on the highway. I mean, as we all know, Lexus is a luxury brand, and it certainly has those attributes. You know, heated and cooled front seats, heated second row seats, and it has captain rows. Captain chairs in the second row. It's got entertainment screens in that second row in terms of attached to the back seats. So you know, they try and build it up. As you know, it's for, you know, if you've got kids, you can take it there. If you want to tow a boat, you can do all of that. But you know, the thing about it is that I have not had a chance to check out sales, but you know, the tooling for this vehicle has been paid for. Tooling, the dies. So what I'm saying is that everyone they sell, just about most of the money, I would think about half of the money goes straight to the bottom line. So I think that's why they keep making it. I think, you know, one of the things that continued or irritated me for the entire week while I had the vehicle was that this, you know, the chassis itself has aged in the sense of there's just certain things you cannot do with the chassis, like lane change signal. There's no lane change signal on this car. So you have to, you know, if you're changing lanes, you have to take the turn signal all the way on versus just click it and it'll flick three times. And I thought that really, really irritates. However, as I say, if you're old school, either in age or in attitude, this is the vehicle for you. Because as I say, it's a big three-row sport utility, a lot of luxury appointments. It's body on frame. So it's certainly, you know, low four-wheel drive, high four-wheel drive, all these sorts of things. And really, I think it comes from an era when bigger was better. You know, Lexus produced this, kind of wedged it right in between the RX and the LX. So that's why, you know, you've got a GX 460. But as I say, they keep selling them. They don't have to sell that many to make a really, really nice profit, because the dog is paid for. I mean, right. The things that consumers don't see, which, you know, as I say, the tools, the dies, all that kind of stuff is already paid for. So, you know, it's gravy. Every time they sell one, most of the money goes to the bottom. Man, it's pretty nice, but as I say, it, you know, it depends on what you want.
And Frank, is that 2019 or 2020, Frank?
It's 2019.
2019, okay.
Frank, is that are those all based on the same platform as the 4Runner? Do you know?
You know, I do not know, but I would think so, because I think that, you know, the platform is a bit smaller than an LX. So I would think it's on the same platform as the 4Runner, because definitely I can tell, you know, I could tell by the way it rode, you know, that even though they it had a sport and comfort setting in terms of drive modes, that sort of thing, you can tell when something is body on frame.
Right.
And that's, you know, that's sitting on a truck chassis.
Yeah.
No, it was nicely done, but it's, you know, it's a truck chassis. No, but as I said, it depends on taste in terms of what you really want.
Before I forget again, Frank, bring us up to date on the UAW and FCA.
Well, that's been settled.
Okay.
You know, and I'm not sure, maybe all the publicity with the upcoming and now done deal impeachment vote and hearing and all of this kind of stuff, this was kind of overshadowed. But basically, this contract has been done. How should you say? It was ratified. I think the last thing I saw was something like 71% of the vote from a ratio standing. It probably was the richest contract because one of the things that came out in the GM suit against Chrysler was that in 2006, 2007, somewhere around there, Chrysler had the highest cost, highest manufacturing cost in terms of wages, so on and so forth. And by 2015 or so, it had the lowest cost. And GM alleges that one of the reasons that it accomplished that is that Chrysler bribed bribed UAW officials heading the Chrysler division. And a lot of people think that basically to get attention away from that suit and try and negate some of the things the suit alleges that Chrysler signed, you know, this what amounts to a fairly lucrative contract vis-a-vis its size. And just let me just go over these bullets for you. Basically, employees got a $9,000 signing bonus for full-time employees. That dropped down to $3,500 for temps. They got a 4% lump bonus in 2019 and 2021. They have 3% wage increases. In 2020 and 2022, a four-year path to full wages instead of 8 years. That's significant because one of the things that a lot of people don't realize is almost two-thirds of Chrysler employees were temps. You know, and that's where they got the cost advantage. They were allowed to hire all these temps. I was really amazed that I think it was 61%, something like that, or maybe 66, I'm not sure. But two-thirds of their employees were temps. They've got, $60,000 retirement incentives, in other words, buyouts, as they get people to retire or try and entice them with these $60,000 buyouts, 13% increase in profit sharing formulas. In progression workers got the same. In progression workers, that means the temps who are in progression to become full-time employees, they got the same health benefits, dental and vision coverage as full wage employees. That's a lot of money.
Right.
You know, yeah, it is, because as you all know, when you're talking about healthcare can be, you know, something like up to 50% of your salary. If you say you got a salary of $50,000, well, the whole package could be $75,000. In other words, $25,000 of that is healthcare, dental, vision, all this kind of stuff. And the temps also got prescription drug coverage, so it was a lucrative deal.
Great, thanks. Okay, Chris.
I'm gonna paint this picture here. Every year It seems as though we could start writing our own farmer's almanac, because every year, whenever we get an expensive convertible for review, it's some of the coldest weather we see it all year. And so because of that, I'm in protest and I'm not going to say anything about that car today. I'm going to wait until it's a nicer day, and I'm going to tell you about a car that I'll be posting its review.
Then all I can say is, you're not a true convertible lover, because I would throw a hat on, a big coat, a scarf, roll the windows up, turn the heat on.
It was 27 degrees. I said, absolutely not. And I don't care if it had the neck warmers and all that other good stuff. They don't work in 27 degree weather.
Okay.
We're going to talk about that another day. But, okay. But the car that I will talk about today is a car that works well in all types of temperatures. Doesn't matter if it's 75 and sunny or if it's snowing and 23 degrees outside. And that is the 2020 Honda Civic Hatchback Sport Touring. They had their mid-cycle refresh. So it's been mildly redesigned for 2020. And it was fabulous when it came out in 2016. And it's still fabulous now. Still a really good car. Honda did a really good job of keeping this car, I don't want to say up to date, because it was just when it launched when the total redesign launched in 2016, I mean, it was just a really good car ahead of its time. The technology was really good. So it's just stood the test of time over these last 3 years or so. With that being said, this car, you know, little four-cylinder engine, but has decent power, CVT transmission, which I'm not a total fan of, but Honda makes one of the better CVTs on the market. So anytime I get in one of those vehicles like the Civic, it doesn't annoy or frustrate me. I actually don't mind it. And to be honest, after a couple of days of driving, I don't even think about it anymore. So, you know, the powertrain's really good. Styling is nice. Again, great technology in this vehicle. Fuel economy, 29 miles to the gallon in the city, 35 on the highway with an average of 32. I averaged about 33 and change. So, you know, you're getting wonderful fuel economy with that, way better than what Frank was getting this week. And and the price, even the price, I'm starting to get used to that now. You know, there used to be a time where you look at the price of these compact cars and you're like, oh my gosh, what is going on here? But it's the norm now. And so with this car, again, this isn't a base version of the Civic. It's pretty much a loaded version. And so the MSRP comes in at $29,780. But with how the size has grown on those cars over the years, and the technology that they put in them, and just how well all the creature comforts and everything, how well they drive, it's hard to even argue that price now. You know, years ago it was, but now, yeah, that 29 grand, hey, you know, $30,000, it's a nice car. It's a nice car. They even brought the volume knob back. You know, that was a big issue when they first launched that car, where it was the touch screen, and it was annoying. You know, I mean, I think most guys over the age of 30 were annoyed by the fact that they had gotten rid of that volume knob, because it was just hard to reach it. There was no tactile feedback or nothing. So when you're driving, you actually had to focus a lot on turning up and turning down the volume, just, you know, of the radio. Well, right. They brought it back. So now you've got a physical knob on there again. I mean, they addressed the concerns, and it's a nice car.
All right. Go ahead,
Frank. Because when he was talking about that screen, you know, touching the screen to raise the volume on that, that was one of the things. And it was the Mazda trip, the Mazda CX-30, that's where I was. One of the things they said is they don't have touch screens for that very reason. Because with a touch screen, you got to reach out, you got to touch it. And that's where your eyes and your focus are. So basically on most Mazdas, they do not have a touch screen. You got to deal with a dial, deal with this, deal with that.
Mazda at least was doing with some of their cars was once you start driving, it disables the touchscreen part.
Right.
When you're in park, you can still use the touchscreen. But once you start driving, you know, then you have to resort back to the physical knobs and switches and all that stuff, which again, I'm totally fine with. That was, you know,
Well, just in addition to that, just in terms of the overall market, when you're talking about small cars, one of the things that they started doing maybe 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago is that they basically were wondering, now when I say they, I'm talking about automakers. They were wondering whether American consumers would pay as much as Europeans do for small cars, small, well-equipped cars. And what they've done over the years is they've slowly brought, you know, stepped them up step by step by step by step, you know, and what that means is dollar by dollar by dollar by dollar. So they walked them up from paying, say, in the low 20s for a small car to close to $30,000 for a small car. But it is well equipped because today, as you say, today's small cars, hey, you know, most of the things that you will find in, say, premium cars, you will find in a small car.
You remember,
like a lane changer.
Yeah, Hyundai and Kia were battling with that, whether somebody would pay $30,000 or close to $30,000 for Hyundai or Kia. You know, that was one of their concerns when they started stepping up in price. But you're talking about stepping up in price. This is what I'm driving this week. It's a Lexus. It's a 2020 Lexus LS500H all-wheel drive. It's loaded with technology, as you can see. 3.5 liter V6, 354 horsepower. It has that CVT transmission like you were talking about, Chris. I'm not opposed to CVTs. I've gotten, like everybody else, pretty much used to them. The exterior color here is a Nightfall Mica. Interior is beige leather. 23 miles per gallon city, 31 highway, 26 combined, MSRP of $98,885. So if you have around 100 grand to play with, you can toss it into this baby. It is very roomy. This is a big car. It has more leg room in the back than you could ever use. I like the fact that it has the multiple driving modes. It's a very, very smooth ride on the highway. As you can see, it's a long car. It's heavy. It's loaded with the safety technology that you guys were talking about. Another thing I like at night, it has automatic bright lights, which is something that you don't find on a lot of cars. And it's some of the little things like that that really make you pay attention to the car and appreciate what this new technology is doing in automobiles. One of the things that just drove me nuts about this car is when you accelerate, the engine is just so noisy, it's unbelievable. You would think that you were in a totally different car once you got up to speed or set the adaptive cruise, how quiet it is. And then you step on the accelerator and give it a little gas, the engine is just unbelievably noisy. I would think you were driving a $15,000 car, not a $98,000 car. But other than that, this is a sweet ride. It's a hybrid, as you can see. For a big hybrid, I guess the fuel economy is okay, 31 on the highway. I was expecting to get, you know, a little better than 31 on the highway in this automobile. But it's a Lexus. It's a luxury car. And it's a lot of automobile. What do you guys think?
Well, 31 isn't bad for a vehicle of that size. Like you said, that's a big car. Those LSs are big. And so, you know, the fact that to get 31, and I guess what's the city rating on that though? Because with it being a hybrid, that's where you might see even
23.
What?
23 city, 31 highway, 26 combined.
Ugh. That's yeah. Moving a lot. That's why that engine makes so much noise when it kicks in. That's a lot of car to move. Because I'll tell you, I've reviewed the V8 version of that car, and I'm sorry, not V. I'm sorry, the V6, the twin turbo V6.
This is the V6, yeah.
But not the hybrid though. It's okay. The twin turbo V6. And the engine is much mellower, it's not as intrusive as the hybrid version where, it'll shut down, you're cruising in near silence, and then all of a sudden it kicks in and you're like, dude, what's going on? You know? So, I think it's just because of that hybrid. When that smaller engine kicks in to start charging those batteries up, it starts making some noises, you know? Besides that, it's a great car though. They're wonderful cars.
Like I said, you're on the highway, man. You get up to speed. It's like you're riding on an air mattress.
Yep.
That's what they're known for. If I may, let me be blunt. Because I was on the launch of the LS, with the turbocharged 6-cylinder. And, if you're going to charge me $98,000, I'll take a turbocharger, actually a couple of them, and a regular transmission. No. Hell no.
What are you knowing, Frank? We're not sure what you're knowing yet.
not this car in the hybrid. Not this car in the hybrid version.
Gotcha.
Because you give me a hybrid and you tell me 23 miles per gallon in the city where it's supposed to be saving gas.
Right.
No. They need to send this back to the engineering shop, because I know they've got the brains and they've got the money to come up with a car that's one, more responsive, two, gets better mileage. Because they've got the frame, they need to go back in and open up that hood and do some stuff in there. Because got the time.
And go for a ride with Roosevelt so they can hear it on the highway.
Yeah, right, exactly.
But I will say this, it seems like we've discovered that their new, and when I say they, I'm talking about Lexus as well as Toyota, but their new color for their press fleet is Midnight Mica. Because I've got one sitting out here.
Everybody has one, huh?
Picked up one. They came and picked up one this morning.
like I said, overall, it's a Lexus luxury, but that noisy engine when you accelerate just it spoiled everything for me as far as I'm concerned. You can say what you want when you do stuff like that, it takes away. I like the fact that with the, like I said, it's the little things that stand out on the car, but something is that comes to engine acceleration, like some of these adaptive cruise systems, when you change lanes and you're getting back up to speed, you get that hard acceleration rather than a smooth acceleration back up to the set point, to your set point, which again is something else that drives me nuts. When we know that the technology is out there to take care of all of those kinds of conditions. We've been talking about affordability, and Ford is taking the initiative. They're taking a serious look at what, since they have so much technology in cars and they know now what you use and what you don't use, what they're looking at doing is going back to what car companies used to do with automobiles, pretty much let you pick what you want, the equipment that you want on a car. Because they're finding that there's a lot of equipment on cars now that's raising the price that people don't use most of the time. So that's taking a serious look at decontenting cars rather than adding more content in cars and basically letting people choose the type of equipment that they want, that they know that they will use to reduce the cost of the car. Because we always talk about affordability. And like Chris was saying, I still don't know how you can accept a $29,000 or $30,000 Honda. Civic. But I guess if they throw that number at you enough times, you're going to figure out, well, it's not going to be any lower, so it becomes acceptable. What do you guys think about decontenting? You think Ford's moving in the right direction?
Well,
yep, go ahead.
Well, that's the challenge right now, is, I mean, in the comments section on my YouTube channel, I get price complaints all day long, every day. That's the one thing that you will hear complaints about every single day is how expensive these cars are. And it doesn't matter, again, if you're talking about a compact Civic or if you're talking about, you know, a Mercedes AMG or something. Like, there, price is always a conversation that comes up. And, you know, a big part of that, I believe it all happened once all of these new technologies started coming in, because they're expensive. They cost all the safety tech that all these cars have now. The infotainment systems, you know, all that, all this stuff costs money, and the automakers aren't going to eat it up. You know, they're not going to absorb it. So somebody has to pay for it, which that's the consumers. And so that's why we saw such big jumps, especially on the low end, such big jumps in pricing in a relatively short amount of time. And, you know, I mean, that's the bad part, is that, you know, everybody wants the tech features. Everybody wants all that stuff. The problem is it's expensive and everybody can't afford all that stuff. So that means that, you know, these companies have to figure out something. They've got to figure out a way to be able to allow people to buy these new cars, but still figure out a way to somehow keep some of the pricing within reason. Because
you're also finding the car companies on the side partnering to reduce the cost of technology. You know, they're trying to come up with a way that the engineering department can get together with other engineering departments and with even other companies to come up with a way to reduce the cost of the technology, because the technology is not going to stop in the cars. You know, they're going to keep introducing the technology, but now they're trying to find a way, okay, how can we merge, use the same technology? You call it this, I call it that, and let's get the cost down, because one company can't just bear all the cost of creating all this new technology.
Yeah, you know, I agree with Chris, as well as both of you, because both of you know, you're saying the same thing. You got to cut the cost. Decontenting is a start, you know, because there's just stuff, you know, that some consumers don't need. You know, you don't need push button start on every car. You don't need heated seats. You know, I grew up in Chicago. We had heated seats. We called it a coat. You know, basically, well, that's what my, you know, my seat warmer was my coat. you don't need, you know, heated and cool seats. You know, there are a lot of things that you don't need, you know, that they put in cars that you don't need. You don't need smart keys, you know, as I said before. So there, you know, so in other words, giving the consumer, and one of the reasons it's amazing, one of the reasons they started putting together packages was so that it would make their manufacturing easier. If their manufacturing is easier, it's cheaper. So where's the money going? You know, if you're still paying more and more and more for this stuff. So, you know, they need to decontent, and if they want to stick to their packaging principles, then they need to come up with cheaper packages.
Right. Okay. Well, I want to thank you guys for taking the time out of your busy travel schedule, Amin and Frank and Chris, to sit in and talk about something that we love, cars and the auto industry. Half hour flies. We used to do an hour. With a half hour, we can throw a whole lot of stuff at you in 30 minutes and give you something to think about. Again, check out the website of each one of the panelists. We're going to take a couple weeks off. Next week is Christmas, so we won't be on that Thursday. And then the week after that will be the day after New Year's. And I know some of you may be a little, what do they call it, inebriated the day after. So we'll come back on, I think it's January the 9th. Give you guys a break, get yourself together, get some time with the family, get your head straight for 2021. But I look forward to seeing you in the new year. I want to wish you guys a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Please be safe on the road. As always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. Buckle up, don't text and drive. And as Frank says, buckle up, don't stream and drive. We'll see you in 2021. Take care, guys.
2020.
Yeah,
I'm thinking, we're only driving 2020 cars.
Yeah, we're driving 2020 cars. You're right, 2020.